I'm not giving my usual neuroscience talk this evening. Instead, I'm speaking on things that were part of my training and pieces, but they're topics that I really love and kind of give me a place to go to when things are very stressful. So, you know, the last few years, the last couple of years have been kind of terrible for everyone. And it's pretty easy to get stuck in, you know, the implications of what it means for a global pandemic and, you know, for spirituality, right? And there are challenges there and, you know, but areas for personal growth. So I want to share this evening some of the items of thought that made me happy and can continue to make me happy, and I hope it'll do the same for you. So I guess the actual title of the talk is The Universe is So Full of Wonders That We Barely Notice Them. Okay. All right. So that's a cove somewhere. And I guess that's the ocean towards the top right there. And you see water is coming through an opening. And as it's coming through an opening, you see ripples. Right, spreading outwards. So this can be reproduced in a lab easily. So if you have take a barrier, and then you cut a hole in the barrier, and then you kind of throw waves at that barrier. What happens is, depending on the width of the hole, you'll get a different pattern. So when the hole is very small, you'll get basically like a triangular pattern. And when the hole is wider, you'll get a slightly larger triangular pattern, but you may also see some areas where you have waves and then an area of stillness and then waves again. And then on the left, you have what it looks like when the opening is much wider than that. So this is called diffraction, right? And so diffraction is a phenomena of all wave-like things. So this is how a prism works. So you have white light from the sun, which is mixed frequencies. It's the rainbow. And then when you put a prism down, what happens is the light that the components of light that have the shortest space between the waves bend the most, right? So as the light is traversing the glass, what you see is essentially at a microscopic level, the blue light is bending further down, whereas the red light is bending less. And so that leads to a spread that creates the spectrum. So it's been known for quite some time that light is wave-like. Right? That's actually been understood for a couple of hundred years at least because of phenomena like this. So light also is particle-like. And I'm not going to go into the details of this, but Einstein got his Nobel Prize for this. It's the photoelectric effect. So if you have a piece of metal and you shine the light on it at a particular frequency, and you have a couple of electrodes at the end, you see that you get current. And that's because the light is kicking out electrons, and then the potential difference creates a current. But the point is, light also has this particle-like behavior. So this leads to so-called wave-particle duality, which is like, you know, it's a word. It doesn't really capture what it is. It's a perception we don't have access to. But, you know, we try to model it, you know, given our limited imagination. So let's say I wanted to understand how this thing works. And I'm going to use my silly, simple understanding and make a diagram and see how this thing operates. So I'm going to call this a particle in a box, right? It's a particle in a box. So it's a little guy who's bumping around from side to side because it's a particle, right? Sure, that's what particles do. But we already know that if this is supposed to be light, then it is also a wave, right? So it looks a little bit like, it should behave like a guitar string, right? This should be something that's oscillating about it. And so that's light as a wave in the particle in a box. So what happens is, as you increase the energy with which this is vibrating, you create sine waves, right? So sine waves are nothing but the rotation around a circle. That's all it is. That's what a sine wave is. You're just going around and around in a circle. And that makes a curve. Like if you plot the where you are in X and Y versus your angle, that produces the sine wave. But all you need to know is the sine wave is actually a graphical representation of going around and around and around. And so the faster you go, the tighter, like the more quickly you get these waves. So a guitar string at its different frequencies is doing that. At different frequencies, at different tones, I'm not a musician, the strings are actually vibrating at different wavelengths. So you have longer ones that have less energy and shorter ones that have more energy. And so it turns out that this behavior is very easy to model mathematically. And it's actually, a guitar string is not so different than a particle on a box, because it's a string that's bounded on both sides by what's called an infinite potential. So like, there's no question as to like anything is influencing the string from the outside. It's not. This is my toy model, right? So what I find is, I have a differential equation, which is what it means is like I have an equation that tells me how something behaves, like, you know, how it moves. From that equation, I'm going to derive a formula for where it is, right? So it's a way of understanding a moving thing and predicting its future and understanding its past, right? So if, when you solve that equation describes this oscillating string. Like you can actually describe the oscillating string with a wave function that's a partial differential equation. So it turns out that the solutions for this equation, meaning things that match the behavior that we see, have this really interesting property that they can't occupy arbitrary levels. So what that means is there are points, no matter, like at different frequencies or different levels of n, there are points that have these intersections with the zero, right? Those are called nodes, right? And so what that is when you're on, you saw the picture of waves coming from the hole, and there are places sometimes where you have a wave, and then there are parts of the surface that actually are very still. So you see this in the water all the time, right? And so that's what this is. That's what this is saying. That in oscillatory phenomena and things that wave, oscillate, there are positions in any solution that actually works, in anything that actually, you know, is possible logically and mathematically and visually, just by doing the thing, what you find is, given a particular energy level, first of all, there are energy levels, and those energy levels cannot be partial. There's no like 1.5, right? The only modes that are allowed are, you know, the equation, for lack of a better word, times one, or, you know, math plays out in a different way. But you see what I'm trying to say, that there's no intermediate stages. There's, in solutions to this problem, there are only discrete levels. So that's quantum mechanics. That's actually what it is. Quantum mechanics is when you have wave-like behavior bounded by some barrier, and that generates these states where there are points where the thing exists and there are points where the thing doesn't exist, right? But the question is, where is the electron, or where is the particle, right? So this is an atom. Everyone has seen this, I'm sure. There's a nucleus in the middle with some protons and neutrons. And then there's some electrons buzzing around, like, it's called the planetary model. And it's, wrong. But it turns out that even that is too complicated to understand, right? After the particle in a box. You can't go from the particle in a box to that. So the next simplest thing you can deal with is hydrogen. Hydrogen. So this is hydrogen. There's one proton in the middle and one electron. Its net charge is zero. If you get rid of the electron, you get a proton, and that's what your stomach is full of, hydrochloric acid. It's a fluid that's very rich in protons, which makes it acidic via interaction with the water. But that's what my point is, that you can take the electron off, and it'll be just a proton. So hydrogen can easily turn into a proton. And proton is a fundamental particle. It was one of the first particles to be created in the model of the Big Bang. Kind of everything else came after, but just like the photon and the electron, the proton was fundamental. And yet it's like completely normal, right? Because it's hydrogen and it's in water and it's everything. So, basically what happens when we try to explain the particle in a box for the hydrogen atom, and we want to explain where the electron is. And what we say is, okay, it's a particle in a box, but it's really in three dimensions. So like a particle in a box in one dimension is like a guitar string. A particle in a box in two dimensions is ripples on water. And a particle box in three dimensions is jello. If you think about that for a second. It's wiggling, and it's increasing density in some areas and decreasing it in others. So mathematically, the same math that we did to derive that particle in a box in one dimension, we expand it to three dimensions. This is all math, right? This is like somebody sitting at a piece of paper and scribbling, right? And so and deriving equations that make sense based on the rules of math. And so this, you see at this top right here, that's a equation for spherical harmonics. It's a fancy name for waves in 3D. And so what happens is the same phenomena happens where any solution that actually, this is the solution for the wave equation, and this solution can never have a partial unit. It can't be like 1.5 or 1.2 or 1.211. It's either 1 or 2 or 3. These are called quantum numbers. And it happens because of the math. It's very simple. You could derive the nature of quantum mechanics with a piece of paper in front of you. And when you expand that a little bit, you get this. So what you see is the areas that are bright are where there is a high probability of an electron being, and the areas that are dark, there's no probability of an electron being. Just like I said before, they're nodes, right? They're the parts of the ripples that just stay still. That's what that is. What you find is, if you have like, a piece of paper or like a towel or something, surface of water, you can shake it many ways, right? Like in one dimension, you just have that guitar string. Like in two dimensions, you can kind of like flop it like this. So the middle goes up and down. You can do it from left to right and front to back, up and down, right? Makes sense. That's what atomic orbitals are. They're just oscillations expressed in three dimensions. And what happens when you do that is you get these different patterns, right? So, on the second row, on the first row, you'll see those are called p orbitals, right? I don't know if anybody can remember chemistry, but that's all it is. It's an oscillation from left to right and when it's bounded. All right, so this is, again, math that you can do on a pencil paper. And so, Let's look at the ones on the right. Those are on the left. Those are s orbitals. Those are the simplest shell of orbitals. And so what you're looking at is like, you know, you're not looking at a bunch of electrons, right? You're not looking at an electron that's moving so fast that it looks like it's buzzing around. No, the electron is that. That is what it looks like. It is delocalized. It doesn't have a place. The concept of a particle being something you can capture and express correct completely is false. This is like mathematically, this is what it is. And you can have other names for it, but that's its actual behavior. So, you know, pretty much the last, like, you know, 100 years, no, 70, 80 years of physics and chemistry have been based on this. But this was only recently able to be imaged, right? So with an actual instrument. And so what they found was, if this is the S orbital, right, for a, this is what we call the probability density, or otherwise the shape of the wave, that's an S orbital. That's what, when you actually capture it with an instrument, that's what it is. It looks exactly like theory would predict, which makes sense because that theory has predicted a whole bunch of other stuff. But it's really beautiful when, you know, we started with this thing that we wrote down on a piece of paper, and we drew some wiggles, and then we, you know, spent a number of years getting a graduate degree, and we figured how to do that in 3D, right? And then we drew something on a paper, and we say, this should look like this. And then you build the rest of your theories on that, and things start to work, and you can predict things. You still haven't seen it yet because you don't have anything that's so sensitive to see something so small. When you finally get there, because you can now build an enormously complicated machine with all everything that you've learned, and you can actually see it, lo and behold, it's the thing that you predicted. So, you know, this is quantum mechanics. This is like basic, in a sense. This is basic chemistry. It's not basic at all, right? But it's basic chemistry. So, what's the size? So, you know, if you look at the middle, that's red, right? That's not the nucleus. That's the area of highest probability of the electron being. As you move further out, you get green, and that has a lower probability. And then you get to this blue ring. That's the node, right? That's the bit of the water that's just holding still, even though everything's flopping around. And then, you know, so forth outside. The nucleus is actually way smaller. The proton is way, way smaller than that. So here, given this is actually helium, so the width of the atom, which is the protons, you know, two protons, two neutrons, two electrons, that's one angstrom, right? And the nucleus is one femtometer. It's 100,000 times smaller. The nucleus of an atom is 100,000 times smaller than its electron density. Which is completely different than like the planetary model that you see, where you have a nucleus and you have some electrons circling around. So you see that model is completely wrong, right? It's 100 years old, and it turns out that much of our understanding of atomic structure has come from the last century. People before that were also very, very smart. It was just hard to do. So, you know, again, starts with a piece of paper, right, and a pencil, and you can predict, you know, behaviors that take you 80 years to finally measure. And it turns out that you can now extrapolate to more complicated systems. So if you want to say, like, okay, what's the, like, let's say I'm a biologist and I want to understand how DNA works, and I say, like, okay, where's the negative charge on a nucleic acid or something that's one of the components of DNA? Well, you can punch that into a computer and calculate it, and it will give you an answer. And, you know, take my word for it, that process can predict electric properties, magnetic properties, vibrational modes. All of this thing is completely explainable mathematically, yet it's totally physical, right? So that's a clue right there that something's really interesting. Something really strange is happening. So this is another example of, this is ATP. This is the fundamental energy molecule that all life is dependent on. everything, bacteria, you know, you, plants. This molecule is the currency of energy in the cell, of any cell. And so this can also be modeled completely mathematically. Like if you had enough paper, you could do it on paper. And now with a computer, you can do more. You can actually model the much larger system that this thing is a part of. So you can actually see how cells manufacture ATP using this molecule, which I'm about to show you, which is the electron transport chain component 4, right? And so it's really beautiful, so I'll play that.
Rows of molecular motors generate ATP, the molecule essential to all life on Earth. Enzymes bring together reactants to form a chemical bond, converting mechanical energy into chemical energy. A ring of enzymes work in step, creating 3 molecules of ATP with each cycle. Inside the molecular motor, a rotating axle powers the sequence. The axle is attached to a rotary molecular motor, moved by the force of protons, pushing from the other side of the membrane.
So that's how ATP is made. You have this layer of fat, which is the surface of mitochondria, and inside it you have a bunch of our old friend, the proton, right? And that's concentrated, just like stomach acid is concentrated. But this is now at a microscopic level. And then you have this proton, this enzyme complex that's jammed inside there, and it's a windmill. Right, it's literally a windmill. Like the wind is the electrons, the protons. Right, so this is amazing. Right, like you know, if somebody asked you to like move water and you thought about it for a while, you'd make a fan that's a windmill, and you'd be able to, you know, you'd be able to get water to flow or crush grain or whatever. Spontaneously, the universe has produced this. Same mechanism. Also, this is completely simulated. This is like I said, you can start with a piece of paper and then add more paper and do more complicated things, and then you get a supercomputer, and then you simulate the entire biological system as you understand it after 80 years of measurements of all sorts of things. And that's what you get. So this is my favorite because it's so beautiful, because you can actually see the rotor like turned. It's incredible. But in DNA synthesis, you get even more incredibly beautiful stuff, right? All right, so this is how DNA is copied. So this is DNA transcriptase. All right, so what it does is it gets a feed of DNA, let's say from the left, and then it splits it open, and then on one of the sides, the direction of the code is moving in the direction of motion. So as the DNA gets split apart, you just add on nucleotides. It's not a problem. However, in DNA, the other strand goes backwards, right? So you can't write backwards. You still have to write forwards. So what this guy does, this enzyme, while on the one side it's spitting out the easily copied DNA, on the other hand it's looping it around and bringing it through. So that's what this looks like. So this is an RNA transcription, where DNA produces RNA. And RNA should be familiar, that's what the COVID vaccine is. So this is bone growth. So vitamin D comes and sticks, gets stuck on that enzyme. And other components are drifting and they come and get stuck. And then this little guy gets sent out. That's what it looks like when RNA is being synthesized. Watch this, it's really cool. You see the copy? This is actually, this is transcription. So you have half of it, and then the complementary side gets slotted in one by one. And now this is the actual speed. This is how fast it's going in real time. And this is like, you know, hundreds of billions of these things are happening inside you right now. Right? Like, inconceivable numbers of something so incredibly complicated and beautiful and just it, you just for you don't even know it. You're walking around and it's, you know. All right, so back to our friend, the proton, right? That's where we started this. And so, well, what else can this tell us, right? So, we said that, you know, the universe when it began was filled with this most simple of atoms, right? So big clouds of it everywhere. But nothing else that's more complicated because it hasn't had time to come together by gravity. So somehow that proton becomes a sun, right? So you have these large clouds of gas, hydrogen. You can go fuel your car with it, right? And there's enough of it in space and large enough a scale that is just, because of gravity, it just starts coming together. And then it produces this object that is so enormous that it compresses itself into turning into a nuclear fire. What you're looking at is a nuclear fireball that is just burning, right? So that's like, when an atomic bomb goes off, it releases all of its, you know, nuclear material in energy in one step. This is that times like a gajillion. It is a constant nuclear fire. So how did that happen, right? So how did we go from like gas to these suns, gas of hydrogen to these stars? So this is how it happens. This is also a total simulation, right? So over time, you get these concentrations of where randomly there's a little bit more density. Then gravity brings these strands of hydrogen together closer and closer, okay? And then there's this swirling mass, right? So it's getting more energetic because it's getting closer and closer and rubbing each other faster and faster and producing more and more heat. And so then at a particular part, you have this critical mass, right? This is just a ton of energy, like that's an understatement, in this part. And now you have this nuclear fusion just began. That's what you're looking at. That little spiral thing that's spinning, that's generating stars. Every dot there is a star, right? It's a hurricane of basically highly energized hydrogen gas that's spinning so fast that every once in a while in that spin, it sticks enough hydrogen together to explode and turn into a sun, right? Okay, so that's awesome. Just watch it for a second, it's nice. Right, it just spins, it just kicks a bunch of suns out because it's like, you know, as it's spinning around. Again, totally simulated, 100% simulated. Right? Now you see these little dots everywhere. These are the suns that were produced by this, started with this hydrogen gas, and now you got a bunch of suns. And so suns come in various sizes, and the sizes of these things are mind-blowing, right? And so that's what this is going to show you. By the way, all the stuff I got from the internet, I didn't make any of it myself. Like, if you YouTube any of the stuff, they're like the first link that pops up. So if you wanted to look at more of this, it's online. So, you know, this is, I cut this from the middle of a video. So on the left, you see the sun, right? So first for perspective. And then the right, you have Sirius A, which is the dog star, right? So you can look up at the sky and see this thing. So now I'm going to what it's going to do now is show you how, like, the progression of size increase of stars. And so what you want to see is, like, it's going to go, like, left and right, and just keep an eye on, like, what happens in the left as the thing scales to show you how big things are relative to each other. Okay, already. That just happened. The sun on the left there. Wait, it's, you can barely see it now. That's Arcturus. Aldebaran. These are, by the way, all these stars were known in the Vedic times too. Rigel. Pistol star. Antares. Betelgeuse. This is a VY Canis Majoris. There's one over. Okay, so, you know, just in case you forgot where the sun was, it's a dot somewhere now. This is an object of the universe. This is a thing that is, that has existed. It's incredible, right? And this is the largest known star. It's called Stefenson 218. That little invisible dot that looks like a piece of dirt on the screen, that's the sun. Right? And that's Stefenson 218. They didn't even, like they, when they were doing the, when they were modeling this stuff in math on paper, there are natural limits that come out from the behavior of the equations. And they didn't think a star could get this big. It exceeds that limit, but it did. So, what happens when one of these things explodes? Right? So, this is really cool. I don't have slides here, so I'll just talk about this. You know that, like, in nuclear stuff, there's this notion of speed. So, like, in a nuclear reactor, you have these fuel rods, which kind of, you know, they're radioactive, but they don't explode. They're just like slowly giving off heat. And that's because you surround it in graphite. So it steals the neutrons as they're coming off. So it doesn't let the chain reaction happen. In a sun or in a nuclear explosion, that does happen. It's a chain reaction. As you get any one kicks off another two, which kicks off four and grows exponentially fast. So the principle is the bigger the star, the faster it dies. So a star, like we saw with Stefenson 218 or VY Canis Majoris, it is so huge and it's producing so much. It is like the chain reaction is so unimaginably large that it will die in 2 million years. Right? Our sun has been around for like, what, 14 billion years? That star will die in 2 million years because it is burning too fast. And so what happens is very strange now. So the reason why this thing is afloat to begin with, why it didn't just collapse, is because of the fire, right? The nuclear fire is, it's fire, so it like goes outwards, it pushes, right? It grows. Right? So that fire is pushing everything out. But there's also the thing that brought it together, which is gravity. So now gravity and that fire are fighting each other, right? And so that, as I said, that fire is coming from nucleosynthesis, like taking two hydrogens, sticking them together to make helium, and then taking a couple of other things to make carbon, another couple of things to make neon. This is all happening inside. Each level of element that is produced in this process releases more and more energy. So as each heavier element is put together, you start generating more energy. So the sun fluffs out, right? And then you get to iron, the element iron. Iron is the most stable element on the periodic table. You can't force it to take more neutrons. Once you're at iron, you're basically out of luck, right? And so your source of energy to push the fire out is gone. So all of a sudden, collapse. The entire thing just falls at like almost the speed of light. Something that big is now collapsing at the speed of light, And the dynamics are really interesting. Like, it's like, it actually looks like if you take a bowl of water, and if you like slosh it around, that's what it looks like. For the first second, for the first 1,000 milliseconds, it looks like there's this, it's like a bowl of water sloshing around. That's actually the, but then it compresses down, and then the matter gets so compressed that if it was more compressed, it wouldn't be matter. And so the thing that's coming in from the outside bounces off. It just flies off. It's like it's a ball that's being thrown at a wall. And the wall is being made because too much stuff is now squeezed in the middle. And that's what we call a supernova, right? And so this is an example of a supernova. And so this is the later stages of a supernova. And you see there's two lobes. Like, so there's, the reason is the way, you know, this is related to how neutrinos are, and I don't even understand this particularly well as to like why there are lobes like this, but there are lobes like this, and you can model it and you can see why, and there's a video of it showing it in a minute. But look at it. This is a picture now, right? Look how beautiful it looks. Like, it looks a simulation. It's not a simulation, it's an actual picture. It's from the Hubble telescope. Okay, so the proton has taken us this far, which is just, I mean, mind-boggling doesn't begin to capture it, right? It's just, so then we look, you know, we're looking around with our telescope and we see this effect. All of a sudden, you know, we're looking at a part of the sky and we see this weird lensy thing, right? It looks like there's somebody put a piece of glass in the sky. And if you look really closely, what's happening is, if you, you know, look at a few of these and you study it for a while, what you're seeing is actually the same image is kind of on the left of the ball as it is on the right of the ball. There's copies of something. The copies of something are showing up in this view, right? What is happening? That's super weird. So, you know, you got to go back to Einstein's thought experiments, right? Really, really, really smart guy. Amazing mind. Thought experiments that are just really, really powerful, right? So basically imagine that space-time is a fabric. And mass, like anything, right? Like you, an apple, like it bends. Mass interacts with space-time. That's just a fact. And when that happens, space-time squeezes around the mass. And so I'll show you a video of like how that leads to gravity. But this is kind of like an example of what you've seen before, maybe, of like, you know, there's the Earth on like a plane, and that makes a bowl because it's bending space-time. And then what you have an orbit because you take a ball and you throw it around the ring, and it there's no resistance, right? So it just keeps going forever and ever. It is the moon circling the Earth, is the moon riding on the rim of a bowl. That's what the model says, right?
Marbles in a bowl.
That's all right. Okay, so then what? So after you do some more digging, that gravitational lensing thing, you find out what that is. That is light bending around a massive object. So the thing is, when you have the light coming from its source, here it's a quasar, and you'll see something about that in a minute, right? It's light coming from a source, right? It's spreading out. But then, you know, after like, you know, billions of light years, it hits this galaxy, which is a really massive thing, right? When you look up the sky, you see the Milky Way. That's the galaxy. It's enormous, right? It's a huge mass. And so that mass is bending space, just like the Earth does. But it bends it at a much larger scale. And so what that means is a straight line isn't a straight line anymore. That's what it means to bend space. It's like if there's a big bend of space in front of me and I threw a ball, the ball would follow the curve of the bend. Maybe it just hit the floor. Like it would coast down and just hit the floor. That's what bend space-time looks like. And so at these scales, which are like billions of light years, that's what's happening. Like now you see the space-time as a fabric. Now it is behaving like a fabric. It's bending. It's, you know, it's like channeling this wave around it, right? So that's gravitational lensing. That's what's happening. There's something in the middle there that is super that's very, very massive. And it's forcing the, what we're seeing is the object behind it. That's what the blue thing is. It's the object behind the massive thing. We can't see the massive thing. We see the thing behind the massive thing because it's bending around the mass because space-time is being bent. Okay, so this is Einstein's, this is a short, very compressed form of Einstein's field equations. These are very complicated equations, but these are equations that describe on a piece of paper that entire process, right? Einstein was not on a computer. He was not on a supercomputer. He was in front of paper, and he was writing this stuff, right? And that is the short form of what he found, and that predicted the gravitational lensing, right? This is from Hubble Space Telescope. You take a picture of the sky, you see that, and you're like, oh my God, this is amazing. That can be derived on paper. Again, very, very strange. And so this is a more accurate representation of that process.
Form space-time, giving it a curvature. For us, the curvature of space-time appears as an endless contraction of the grid. In technical terms, we say that the volume contained between geodesics shrinks over time because of the curvature. This grid that shrinks represents what we call inertial frames, frames in freefall. With respect to this grid, a body that is not subject to any force will conserve its movement. Thus, if we drop the apple with no initial velocity, as no force acts upon it, it will remain motionless relative to the grid. But as the form space-time, giving it shrinks over time.
I wanted to emphasize a point that's really helpful, that apple is really helpful. So you see that apple. Okay, and you see it's kind of moving inwards. And what they said in this video, I'm just repeating what they said, is the apple looks like it's moving, but it's not moving with respect to its position on the grid. The grid is the same. Its position relative to the grid is not changing. The grid itself is moving. And as that happens, it pulls the apple along. This is the model of gravity. Sorry, go back. As I'll finish playing that.
Form space-time, giving it a curvature. For us, the curvature of space-time appears as an endless contraction of the grid. In technical terms, we say that the volume contained between geodesics shrinks over time because of the curvature. This grid that shrinks represents what we call inertial frames, frames in freefall. With respect to this grid, a body that is not subject to any force will conserve its movement. Thus, if we drop the apple with no initial velocity, as no force acts upon it, it will remain motionless relative to the grid. But as the grid contracts, the apple will fall.
Okay. It's amazing that somebody thought of this with paper, pencil and paper. Okay, so that's a lot, right? What are some other consequences of this thing? Are there? So you look up at the sky and you see this thing, right? It looks like a star maybe. And so I'm gonna take my telescope and increase the magnification a little bit. And then that's what that looks like. Bigger and clearly very bright. But then when we zoom up on it, if we finally build a telescope that can see into that, you see this. So what you see is a star or something burning really brightly and a jet coming out of one of its, you know, on an axis, right? Those are called relativistic jets. And what is producing that? Looks like a black hole. So basically, there's some process of circulation, right? And it's basically, there's something spinning around something. And, you know, the thing that's spinning around is producing so much heat and so much pressure that it like doesn't have anywhere to go. So it just goes out. It follows the magnetic field lines out. And it generates these big lobes. And so just, I think it was last year or the year before, we were able to take the first picture of a black hole with a telescope. That's that. That's Messier 87. Right? So it took, you know, how many, you know, 100 years, roughly, since like this idea was thought of, for the image of this thing to finally be taken, right? Similar with the electra, the hydrogen atom that I showed you before. Like, it, you know, you had that on paper, and then it took you 100 years, and then you finally actually saw the thing. And that's what that is. And so what this is the this is what it is. It's a piece of paper, and somebody took a pen or pencil and drew dots in the shape of what the field equations would look like after he solves them, right? He goes and solves the field equations for something of that mass. And he sees like, okay, I think it's going to be like this. He takes a pin and then he draws dots showing where's the density going to be. And he, based on what the equations say and the dots that he just placed, he sees that. Okay, he doesn't know what that is, right? In a sense, you know, like he doesn't know why does it look like it's a black hole? Why do I see a half moon? He obviously knew. What it is you're seeing the back of the disk that's around the black hole, because the black hole curves so much that the thing is that's behind looks like it's in front, because space is that curved, right? And so, you know, that's what a black hole looks like. If you saw Interstellar, that's the correct model of the black hole. Kip Thorne actually worked with NASA, the producers of the film to actually work the equations out, and then they simulated that. That's what that is. That's what this is. So, I'll show you another clip, which is, you know, crazy.
I'm so large that stars seem ridiculously tiny compared to them.
Black holes.
The galaxy Cygnus A has a supermassive black hole with 2.5 billion solar masses and 14.7 billion kilometers wide, which would mean that if it took the place of our sun, it would swallow all the planets and stretch halfway to the edge of our solar system. It's devouring so much mass and material that it churns its disk into a kind of magnetic funnel, spewing gas out, making tremendous radio lobes towering over the galaxy.
I just wanted to note that, you know, how much mass, like what is it like to make a black hole? If you took a mountain, arbitrarily big mountain, it would only be a black hole if it was the size of a proton. That's how dense matter has to be to produce a black hole. Mountain and the proton that I showed you a little while. If you shrink it down, then it becomes a black hole. Hold on. This is really crazy.
I'm so large that stars seem ridiculously tiny compared to them. The galaxy Cygnus A has a supermassive black hole with 2.5 billion solar masses and 14.7 billion kilometers wide, which would mean that if it took the place of our sun, it would swallow all the planets and stretch halfway to the edge of our solar system. It's devouring so much mass and material that it churns its disk into a kind of magnetic funnel, spewing gas out, making tremendous radio lobes towering over the galaxy, 500,000 light years in diameter. That's 2.5 Milky Ways wide. Another pretty large supermassive black hole sits in the galaxy Messier 87. It has 6.5 billion solar masses and was the first black hole we got an actual photo of, or rather of the glowing gas around the edge of a menacing shadow. This sphere of darkness is so large that it covers our entire solar system. And yet, there is a scale even above these kinds of objects. Ultramassive black holes. Now we reach the most massive black holes, perhaps the largest single bodies that will ever exist. These black holes have eaten so much that they've grown to tens of billions of solar masses, their gravity the engine for a quasar, an accretion disk shining brighter than thousands of galaxies full of stars. So massive that they deserve a title of their own, ultra-massive black holes. The ultra-massive black hole at the center of galaxy OJ287 is 18 billion solar masses. It's so big that it has a supermassive black hole nearly 40 times larger than Sagittarius A star orbiting it. This thing defies imagination and is really hard to compare to anything. It can comfortably fit three solar systems side by side inside of it. Let's end this insane competition and get to the King of Kings. TUN 618, a black hole that we can observe consuming galaxies worth of matter, is shining with the brightness of 100 trillion stars, visible from 18 billion light years away. It has an incredible 66 billion solar masses, a black hole so large that it would take light a week to reach the singularity after crossing the event horizon. About 11 solar systems could sit inside of it, side by side. It may very well be the largest single body in the universe, but in reality, it's...
So, again, mountain, event horizon the size of a proton. That thing is 11 solar systems wide. So imagine how much mass is there. So, I'm almost done. Okay, so then this is the universe at the end of the day. So I think this is debated, but I've heard it from a number of places. If you simulated what it would be like to go inside a black hole, right? So funnily enough, the larger the black hole, the more time you can spend inside it without being ripped apart. So a small black hole will suck you in and rip you apart right away. One of these supermassive black holes, you can like move past the event horizon, not even know you're there, right? And the event horizon, by the way, I mean, you'd know because the event horizon is not the place, like, you know, black hole has so much gravity, even light can't escape it, right? That's not exactly the right thing. The black hole is so curved that every direction is down, right? That's why light can't leave. There is no path that goes out. And so, in a supermassive, whatever, you're in a big black hole and you're not dead yet. And so as you kind of go further in past that event horizon, what you see is a picture like this after a little bit of time. And now, we didn't talk about the time aspect of relativity, but time speeds up as you're closer to a gravitational object and slows down when you're farther away. When you're moving to the center of a black hole, where the gravity is so strong, time is moving so fast for you that you literally watch the universe evolve in front of your face. So before you hit the end, before you hit the singularity, right before you hit the singularity, you will have watched the entire universe happen. And then you die, you know. So I guess, you know, again, we started with this guy. Like, you know, you have a lot of it in you. That's an understatement. So, you know, the question that everybody struggles with still is a really fundamental one. Why is the universe mathematically perfect? Like everything we did on paper is replicated in the physical world with astonishing accuracy. I'll tell you another story. You know, the speed of light, like it's 300,000 kilometers per second, it wasn't measured. It was predicted based on the relationship of electric charges to each other and magnetic fields with each other, which you can measure. Basically, it turns out that the only reality that can support those measurements of like electric and magnetic charge are a measurement is a reality where the speed of causality is limited, and that's what light, the speed of light really is. It is the speed of causality. It's the speed of light because light isn't like light doesn't have a speed limit, so it goes as fast as it can. The limit it's hitting is nothing can happen faster than that, right? And so, I forgot where I was going with this, but hold on, I think I'll get it. Yes, okay. Well, I mean, yes, that's right. Yes. So it was predicted, and then it was measured, and then it was like, oh yeah, that was wrong. It was the prediction was wrong by about 3%. Crazy. So that's it. So on that note.
First, thank you for this beautiful lecture. I have one question at this moment. What is the speed of causality?
So the speed of causality is 300,000 kilometers per second, according to the math and every measurement that you can make. So there's like, in terms of the models that we have, the stuff we've written down on paper that seems to be predicting some things, you can't get anything to happen faster than it. It is a speed limit, at least in the models that we have. However, that doesn't mean that nothing can go faster than that. Space can move faster than that, right? So, you know, the universe is expanding, they say that. The reason why they say that is because as light is moving away from you, the universe, it looks like when you look into the sky, things that are farther back look redder. And that's because space is stretching and taking something that was blue and making it red. That's gravitational redshift. That's how they know the universe is expanding. That's happening faster than the speed of light. And when you fall into a black hole, right at the end, you're moving nearly at the speed of light.
Is it possible to explain it conceptually? Let's take a very simple example of causality, and if possible, from there to explain conceptually what is the speed of causality. This is the question.
I'm stumped. Could you say that one more time?
Right. The very concept of speed of causality, I would like to start with an example of causality. And after the example of a causality, for example, the relationship between clay and pot, right? I take a piece of clay and shape it into a pot. There is a causality between clay and pot. So this is an example. Then I ask the question, what is the speed of causality between clay and pot? Can we measure it? You gave us a number, but now I take a very simple example. There is a piece of clay and I shape it into a pot. Clay is cause, pot is effect. How do you determine the speed of causality in this particular case of clay and pot?
So, question, I mean, honestly. So, obviously there are a lot of interactions, right, that happen between the clay and the pot, right? Those interactions that happen at some atomic level, as best we know, have that speed limit. That's not really what you're asking, right? It's more the experience of the clay and the pot. So really the question is, how fast is experience? It's hard to say, right? How fast is experience? You know, I've thought about this, right, a little bit. So one observation is consciousness, super weird. Super weird, right? What is it? Why should it be? Like, there is, but the thing is, it's not like, okay, there's this, a lot of conversation around mind, body, and mind is, your consciousness is in the universe. You are inside the universe right now, and consciousness is happening inside it. Consciousness is a consequence of how the universe is built. It is, there's nothing magical about it, right? We don't have the science to describe it, but it is a physical phenomenon, like magnetism or electricity. Someday we'll figure out what it is, maybe never. But I think the question is, what is the, what's the time interval there? And there is an example of something that doesn't have an interval. One is the center of a black hole, because what happens when a star collapses is, it goes, like I said before, like, it can't be matter anymore. And so what that means is, what happens is space, there's space between space, but you can squeeze it and it gets smaller, and you can squeeze it and get smaller. You can go to zero, right? So that means all of space is at a single point. The other example of that is the beginning of the universe. It's, the Big Bang wasn't an explosion. The Big Bang was an expansion. So before the Big Bang, you had, if there is such a thing, you had everything at a single point because space did not exist. And then, so like, it's zero. And then anything you add on top of that becomes infinitely larger than zero. So there's this thing of, there are infinities and there are zeros. And so within this fabric, whatever this experience is, it very well could be that there could be an infinite, I mean, there's no actual time limit. But that's an excellent point. That's right.
You just say that consciousness is within the universe. We can also say that the sun is within the universe. According to this paradigm, is there anything outside the universe?
By definition, no. Because that's, you define the universe. It's not something you actually can measure. You say, you assume that there's a thing that is everything. That's the universe, full stop. So anything you experience, anything you can think of is happening inside that, because that's how you defined it.
So this is a definition of the human mind.
Right.
Human mind defines it, therefore it is within the universe.
Right.
What precludes, what prevents the human mind to define it differently?
Nothing.
So the same mind can define it as outside the universe.
True. But then what does outside mean?
Right. Exactly. What outside is will also be defined by the same mind.
Fair.
So the question is, where is that mind located? Within the universe or outside the universe?
Well, I guess that's that relates to the content of experience. It's the content of thought, right? The content of, right? And so is that content bound by any spatial boundary, right? So, no.
So if we go a little further, where is the universe?
Thought.
And where is thought?
By the definition of the universe, it would be everywhere.
One more step. Where is everywhere?
For anything that is sentient, it's everywhere is everything that the sentient being can perceive. And that's it. In some capacity, perception in some capacity.
I think I will stop here.
Thank you.